Dear students, in this chapter 3, we are going to study kingship, caste and class. In your previous chapter, kings, farmers and towns, we discussed on important political and economic changes that took place in the period from 600 BC to 600 CE. In this chapter, we are going to focus on the rules and regulations that governed the society from 600 BC to 600 CE. Let's recapitulate what we did in the previous chapter. We discussed on the development of various empires, Mahajanpadas, so economic changes that took place in that period, and the various sources to understand the history of 600 BC to 600 CE. In this chapter, we'll be discussing on important topics, that is your critical edition of Mahabharata, rules governing the society, kingship, patrilineal society, rules of marriage, gotras and its rules, social differences within the framework and beyond the framework of caste. A number of important changes occurred in economic and political life of India during the period from 600 BC to 600 CE. As right now I mentioned about development and growth of various Mahajanpadas, the 16 Mahajanpadas, early empire, the Mauryans, then economic changes, development of trade, urbanization, growth of cities and towns, and coins and currencies. These changes which occurred left a deep mark on the contemporary society. With the expansion of agriculture, the various new strategies were adopted to increase the production. In this period, emergence of different crafts and distinct social groups also witnessed during this period. Due to the social changes which took place in the society, social disparities began to increase as a result of unequal distribution of wealth. And historians made use of textual tradition for many reasons. According to the text written in ancient period, the most popular and famous is Mahabharata, which was composed between 500 BC to 500 CE. And historians believe that it was written by Vedvyas, but most of the historians think that it is the creation of many authors. Originally, Mahabharata had 8800 verses and was known as Jail, but later more verses were added and it became 1 lakh verses. It's the longest epic in the world, Mahabharata. Historians have referred to this text Mahabharata as it regulated the social norms of the society. As we'll be discussing on various topics in this chapter, there are examples that how Mahabharata regulated the social norms of the society, how it governed the society. Vishnu Sitaram Sukthankar, under his leadership, critical edition of Mahabharata was prepared. Let me tell you that Mahabharata was translated into many languages in the vast stretch of this country, from north to south, to east to west. It was translated into many languages, not only in India, but also abroad it has been translated. And it's manuscripts were collected from all over India. And in 1919, Dr. V.S. Sukthankar, or Vishnu Sitaram Suktankar, who was an eminent Indologist and scholar of Sanskrit. Indologist means the one who is interested in history. He is principally known as general editor of the critical edition of Mahabharata, which was published by Bhandarkar Oriental Research Institute, Pune, India. From 1919 to 1966, it took almost a span of 47 years to prepare this critical edition of Mahabharata. Dr. V.S. Suktankar, along with his team of scholars, were indulged in this task of preparing. Initially, they collected Sanskrit manuscripts of the text written in variety of languages from different parts of the country. And the team compared verses from each manuscript. Ultimately, they selected the verses that appeared common to most versions and published these in several volumes. 19 volumes it was published, running into 13,000 pages. This critical, almost 47 years to complete. There were several, could see here, Bhandarkar Institute of Oriental Studies, Mahabharatam. This is the critical edition. Mahabharata's original version was written in Sanskrit, and there were common elements in the Sanskrit versions of the story evident in manuscripts found all over the subcontinent from Kashmir to Tamil Nadu. Also evident were enormous regional variations in the ways in which the text has been transmitted over the centuries. These variations were documented in the footnotes and appendices of the main text. Almost 1,259 manuscripts were collated, that is collected, consulted, and study was made. That's why it took almost 47 years to complete this critical edition of Mahabharata. The best edition of Mahabharata, we can say. Even in many foreign countries, the scholars have studied this critical edition and they have translated it in their own language. Now, Mahabharata, how does it regulate the social norms of the society? What were the various rules governing the society at that time? Why there was a need for rules and regulations to be governed? First, we will discuss on the topic kinship. What is kinship? It's a system of relation between such relatives which determine our relationship on the basis of lineage. These relations were based on lineage or vamsh that are developed by a family. Kins, in a simple word, I can call you kinship. It means your own blood relationship. If your family tree is there, I have an example to show. Your great-grandparents, grandparents, uncle, auntie, your mother, father, and the offsprings of your uncle, aunt, and your mother, father, that is your cousins, come under the one who belong to the same family and share the resources. They come under the same kins. Patrilineage, which means descent from a father to son, that is your patrilineage, from grandson to great-grandson. And patrilineage was prevalent even before Mahabharata, but Mahabharata strengthened it. Families, what is a family? We all live in a family. Families are usually a part of larger networks of people defined as relatives, or to use more technical term, that is your kin folk. We notice that all families are identical. They vary in terms of number of members, their relationship with one another as well as kinds of activities they share. Often, people belonging to same family share food, resources, work, and live together and perform rituals together. While family ties are often regarded as natural and based on blood, they are defined in different ways. Some societies regard cousins as being blood relations, while some may not. For early societies, historians can retrieve information about elite families fairly easily. It is, however, far more difficult to reconstruct the familial relations of ordinary people. About the rich ruling elites, one could know about them from various inscriptions, the textual sources, but about ordinary people, it was difficult for the historians to reconstruct about them. But generally, a family, a kins, it means in a nutshell about the blood relationship which we share. You could see here the patrilineal, the first picture, that is descent from a father. We have patriarchal society in India, except in some places where matriarchal society, but patriarchal means the father is the head of the family. So patrilineal means descent from a father to son. And in the second, we could see your family tree, that is your grandfather, father, mother, your uncle, aunt, and their offsprings. They are our kins. This is the tree of Kuru lineage. Let me in brief tell you about this lineage. Shantanu was the king of Hastinapur and he got married to Ganga. Ganga, whenever she gave birth to her offsprings, it died. She was not able to save her offsprings. Only the eighth one whom she gave birth was Devrat. Ganga lived separately from her husband. One day Shantanu went for a hunt and he saw a Kevat Kanya, Satyavati. He fell in love with Kevat Kanya and he proposed her father to get married. But father kept this vow, that is a condition that the child born to Satyavati will be the successor. But Shantanu did not agree to it, as the legitimate successor to the throne was Devrat. Hence, he came back. Devrat saw his father's grief. He tried to find out what was the matter. He came to know and he approached the Kevat and he asked him to get Satyavati married to Shantanu. But the same condition was put forward by the Kevat, that Satyavati's son would be the successor to the throne, and Devrat promised him that he would remain unmarried. And from that time, for this vow, he is known as Bhishma Pitama. Satyavati was married to Shantanu and she gave birth to two sons, Chitrangad and Vichitravirya. Chitrangad died in a battle and Vichitravirya was also not keeping in good health. He couldn't get married. Satyavati was concerned as she wanted a successor to the throne of Hastinapur. There was a Swayambar of the daughters of Kashi Naresh, Amba, Ambika and Ambalika. In those days, Swayambar was there when eligible bachelors, that is of the royal blood, they used to go to be the groom of the bride of the princess, and the princess used to select on the basis of merit. Their king Shalva was there and Bhishma went to Kashi Naresh and he asked for the daughters, but he refused. So he defeated King Shalva and he kidnapped Amba, Ambika and Ambalika. Ambika started crying as she expressed her love for King Shalva. So Bhishma freed her, but Amba and Ambalika were married to Vichitravirya. Vichitravirya died soon after the marriage without an heir to the throne.
Hence, Satyavati called sage Vyas. In those days, the practice of Niyog was there. If a queen's husband died without giving her heir to the throne, she could have the relationship with a sage, and that practice was known as Niyog, and the child born could be the successor. Amba, she saw sage, his ugly look, she closed her eyes, and it was said that blind Dhritarashtra was born. And Ambalika, she was scared to see the sage. Therefore, Pandu was born. Pandu, Pila, that is from the birth he had jaundice. Satyavati again wanted Amba to meet with the sage. But this time Amba was again scared and she sent Dasi instead. And the Dasi was fearless. Hence she gave birth to Vidur, the most intelligent man in Mahabharata. Then Pandus, he got married to Kunti and Madhuri, and five sons of Pandu, of Kunti, your Yudhishthir, Arjun and Bhim, and Madhuri, Nakul and Sahadev. Gandhari was married to Dhritarashtra and she gave birth to 100 sons who were known as Kauravas. As per the legitimate successor, since Dhritarashtra was eldest, but he was blind in those days, those who were physically able could only become the king. Therefore, for this defect, Pandu succeeded the throne. Pandu died, leaving his sons in the custody of Dhritarashtra. As per the rule, Pandu's eldest son, Yudhishthir, had to succeed the throne. But Duryodhan became jealous, who was the eldest son of Dhritarashtra, eldest among the Kauravas. He wanted the throne himself. So Mahabharata was a feud between the two warring cousins for the throne of Hastinapur. We'll be discussing in the next of patrilineage, as we see the descent from father to son. Patrilineage, as I mentioned, descent from father to son and grandson and so on. Matrilineage, descent from mother to son. Mahabharata describes a feud over land and power between two groups of cousins, the Kauravas and Pandavas, who belong to a single ruling family, that is Kurus, a lineage dominating one of the Janpadas at that time. Under patrilineage, the kings could only claim the resources and inherit the throne. Being the eldest one had the right to inherit the father's throne. Most of the ruling dynasties claimed to follow this system, although there were variations in the practice. Sometimes where there were no sons, brothers succeeded one another, and sometimes other kinsmen claimed the throne. Exceptions were also there in patrilinear society, as we have seen in the case of Prabhavati Gupta, who was the daughter of Chandragupta II and Kuberanag, and she was married to Vakataka ruler Rudrasen II. And Rudrasen II died and his sons were minor, so the queen ruled on the behalf of her minor sons. Mahabharata is an example of patrilineage. There is an excerpt from Adi Parvan. Adi Parvan is the first part of Mahabharata. Mahabharata is divided into 18 parvans or 18 parts, and the first part is your Adi Parvan. Mahabharata is written in Sanskrit and its language is simpler than that of the Vedas, and it describes about the Kauravas and the Pandavas, and the Kauravas who were the sons of Dhritarashtra and the Pandavas who were the sons of Pandu were their cousins. Since Dhritarashtra was blind, he could not ascend the throne, as I mentioned, as at that time also, for being a king, one should be physically able. Not a disabled person could
become a king. And there was a jealousy from the side of Duryodhan, as he felt that he would never be able to ascend the throne by right. It belonged to Yudhishthir, who was the eldest son of Pandu. Therefore, the feud took place between the two cousins, and it lasted for 18 days. You can see here the picture of Mahabharat, the two warring cousins. Now, what was the need of Dharma Sutras and Dharma Shastras? Previous chapter already we have discussed in details about Dharma Sutras, that it was written to govern the society, rules and regulations, how a king should govern, and the relationship between a king and his people. Next, that is Dharma Sutras were written by various rishis like Apshtamba, Bodhanya, but it was in a prose form. And it was Dharma Shastra were compiled in the later Vedic period in verses form, and it means righteous living and code of conduct. It was not the work of a single author. As the development of society led to a complex social life, people used to meet with each other for trade purpose, and they began to question the different beliefs and practices. Therefore, there was a need for the rules to govern the society, and Dharma Shastras were written. Another important, that is your Dharma Shastra, it is here, Manu Smriti. Saint Manu, who was an economist, jurist, who gave the law, that is the code of social conduct. And rules were compiled by Bhrigu Rishi from 2nd century BC to 2nd century CE. The first 58 verses were attributed to Saint Manu, and later more than 2000 verses was added by his disciple Bhrigu Rishi. Later on, William Jones of Asiatic Society of Bengal translated it as an institute of marriage. You see here Bhrigu Rishi, here Manu Smriti. Now, what were the different types of marriages? What were the different rules? Today also we have marriage, arranged marriage is there, love marriage is there. But what were the rules at that time? We are going to focus on it. Endogamy, it meant the marriage within the same unit of family, which is not permitted in the Hindu families. Exogamy meant marriage outside the family unit, and it was permitted as within the same blood relationship, marriage was not permitted. Polygyny means a man marrying more than one wife. Polyandry, a woman having more than one husband. Then there was anulom marriage, a man of higher varna marrying a woman of lower varna, and the offspring born was accepted. Later in this chapter, we are going to study with Bhim's marriage with Hidimba, an example of anulom marriage. Pratulom, if a woman of higher varna married a man of lower varna, the offspring born was not accepted in the society. Then monogamy also means a man having a single wife. As we discussed about the two forms, endogamy and exogamy, the lives of young girls and women belonging to elite families were often carefully regulated to ensure that they were married at right time to a right person. This gave belief that kanyadan, or gift of a daughter in marriage, was an important religious duty of a father. What was kanyadan? Now also in arranged marriages, in Hindu marriages, we see the ceremony of kanyadan. Before the marriage, the first ceremony that takes place is kanyadan, when bride's father and mother hold her hands and they gift their daughter to the groom's family. That is kanyadan. After the kanyadan, the girl, she belongs to the family of her husband. From 500 BC, marriage norms were compiled in Sanskrit texts known as Dharma Sutras and Dharma Shastras and Manusmriti. And these texts have recognized as many as 8 forms of marriage. What were these 8 forms of marriage? Let's discuss about it. The 8 forms of marriage, you can see it here, the arranged marriage. The first 4 forms were accepted. First one is the Brahma marriage. In this form of marriage, the father of a bride chose a man, a learned man in the Vedas and known for his good conduct, and gives his daughter in marriage to him after decking her in jewels and costly garments. This is considered the best type of marriage. For example, today's also marriage, arranged marriage, when the parents find out an eligible bachelor for their daughter, and marriage is exogamy, that is not getting married within the same blood relation but outside the family unit. Then Deva marriage was when a daughter is groomed with ornaments and gifted to a priest who duly officiates the wedding ceremony, during which a sacrifice is performed. Then Arsha marriage, in this the father gives away his daughter after receiving a cow and bull from the bridegroom. This was not considered a form of payment or dowry but a gift of appreciation. Then Prajapatya, like today's marriage, again like Brahma, the father gives away his daughter after blessing the couple by reciting the words, "May both of you perform your dharma." And couple is expected to perform civic and religious duties together, because of these duties are imposed as a condition of marriage. And this marriage was also similar to Brahma marriage. So these 4 forms of marriage was acceptable in the society. Then Gandharva and Asur marriage. Gandharva means, that is the voluntary union of a maiden and her lover, like today's love marriage. This was not acceptable, but there were exceptions at that time. We can give example of Dushyant and Shakuntala. And Asur marriage, in this the bridegroom receives a maiden after bestowing wealth to the bride and her kinsmen, that is selling of a bride, and it was considered inferior. But in many of the tribal societies at present also, there, that is, this form of marriage is prevalent. Then last 2 forms, that is Rakshasa and Pachas form, was not at all accepted in the society. In Rakshasa, it is forceful abduction of a maiden from a home after her kinsmen have been slain or wounded and their houses invaded. That is, after a battle, the violent incident, the bride is forced into the marriage. And in Pachas form also, a girl is seduced who is sleeping or intoxicated, who is mentally imbalanced or handicapped, and she is forcefully married. We can refer to source 3, that is of your book, part 1, page number 58 of Manusmriti, mentions the 8 forms of marriage, but the first 4 forms of marriage were accepted in the society. The last 2 forms were not at all accepted, as it was against the wish of the bride. Next, we'll be focusing on Gotra and its rules. According to Rig Veda, the Gotra means people who lived in same cowshed. As the Aryans came, and they, for them, the cattle wealth, since they were agriculturists, cattle was their main wealth, and especially cow. So earlier, these tribes, they used to live under the same cowshed, and from there, historians say that Gotra has originated. But in Hindu culture, the Gotra is considered to a lineage. It refers to people who are descendants in an unbroken male lineage from a common male ancestor or patrilineal, and usually they are the descendants of seven Vedic seers: Bharadwaj, Vishwamitra, Gautam, Vasishtha, Atrey, Kashyap and Shandilya Rishi. From these seven rishis, the lineage, the descendants, therefore those who belong to one gotra, they are said to be the descendant of one rishi and of the same family. And rules of gotra, marriage between the same gotra was not permitted, and women could no longer retain their father's gotra after marriage. They had to adopt their husband's gotra. Here is the picture of Bharadwaj Rishi. But exceptions were there at that period also. Satavahanas who ruled Deccan adopted their mother's gotra. Metronymics was there, the names derived from mother. Some of the Satavahana kings, they practiced polygyny, that is married more than one wife, and you could see their wives belonging to the same gotra. Endogamy, marriage between the same kin, was permitted among the Satavahanas. Right now I mentioned that some of the ladies were descendants of the same Vedic seer. We can cite the reference to your chapter, source 4, page number 29 of the chapter. That is the names of several generations of Satavahana rulers recovered from inscriptions. From inscriptions we come to know about the Satavahana rulers. The uniform title Raja, and it ends with Puta, a Prakrit word meaning son. Like Gautami Putas, Siri Satkarni, who was one of the greatest king of Satavahana, he was the son of Gautami, and Gautami was the descendant of Gautam Rishi. Then Vashiti Puta, Siri Satkarni, we can see here, Vashiti was the mother and she was the descendant of Vasishtha Rishi. Then Siri Pulomoy Gautami Puta Semi Sami Siri Yana Satkarnija, that is again the mother's name is Gautami and she is descendant of Gautam Rishi. That means that endogamous marriage was there, as some of their mothers were the descendants of the same Vedic seer. So Satavahana's metronymics was there. They followed their descent from the mother. They adopted the gotras of their mother. And endogamous marriage was there. But despite the fact that endogamy was there, metronymics was there, but still patrilinear succession was there among the Satavahanas. We can see here the Satavahana empire in the Deccan parts of Maharashtra with their capital as Pratishthana. Now, next content will be presented in part 2. Thank you, Mrs. Vinita Sharma, DAV Public School, BSEB Colony, Patna. Hope you like my session. Like and subscribe.